So to continue with what I shared last week I spoke on believe and behave. It's okay to behave and then believe. But as we grow in Christian maturity, this is how it should go. Believe, then behave. But for Abraham, it was different because that's how it started. So to start as a new believer, or in certain things, maybe God will ask you to do. You will not know, you will not understand, but you do it. Then you will be able to understand. But in every common thing that we do in our life, you know, the life, for example, if you talk about me, you know, the common things as a husband, as a father, as a friend, as a neighbor, how I need to behave, I need to have an understanding. I need to have an understanding of each position that I hold or each thing that I do. That's why last week what we saw is, so what is important is to believe and then behave. We have done it earlier. Because of situations we have spoken or we reacted or acted, then we said, oh, then we thought about it. But as we grow in Christian maturity, if you want to see God's purpose being fulfilled in your life, if you want to see fruitfulness in your life, and if you want to see, you know, your life, blessing others and glorifying God, and I believe we need to give importance to this. We need to believe and then behave. So last week what we saw is redemption is all about believing. We saw from which book, which chapter? Can somebody tell me quickly the 5 things I shared? Which book? Romans or Acts or Ephesians? Some even say Genesis. Which book? Come on. I don't know what you're doing in the discipleship, study. Acts chapter 10 from verse 36. Can you repeat after me? Acts chapter 10 from verse 36. We saw 5 things. Jesus Lord. Okay. He came in, went about doing good. He went to the cross and died for our sins. He rose again. He's coming back to judge the dead and the living. This is what his good news is all about. And the Bible says, whoever believes is saved. Amen. So when we believe, we are saved. Nothing more should be added to it. Because it is grace of God. So not only for salvation, then as we journey in this life following Christ, we know for sure, please listen. We know for sure, then we need to follow till the end. Those who follow till the end and finish successfully will experience salvation. Amen. So those who go till the end. So in this journey, there are a lot of things we need to believe. That's why God has given us the word. That's why God has given us the word, the Bible. Not just Paul, he wrote 13 letters. Everything what Jesus spoke, he taught, he preached, which we call it as the apostles' doctrine, the teachings of Jesus, is there to help us. To believe means to understand what is life is all about, what is family is all about, what is parenting is all about, what is business is all about, what is ministry is all about. Are you listening? Amen. So what is relationship is all about? What is forgiveness is all about? Everything is there in the word. So that's why we need to have an understanding. We need to believe. Then automatically our behavior will be according to what we believe. So in this journey, the first thing about believing, we need to know a lot of things about believing. About how to live a Christian life. But the first important thing In believing, the first and foremost important truth that has to be understood in order to live this new life with great effect is this. You know what is that? Everlasting life. Can you repeat after me these words? Everlasting life. And also Bible, you know, puts it like this. Eternal life. John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have what? Not just life. It talks about eternal life. Everlasting life. Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. These words are so important. 1 John 5:13, it says, that you may know, you should know about this. I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. Even this morning, I believe, as a church, we need to have a strong understanding before believing in all the other things, before having a deeper understanding, deeper revelation about all the other things, deeper teaching and all the other things. The first thing that we need to believe, we need to understand is eternal life. When we believed in Jesus Christ, what we have received is eternal life. What life? Come on, a little louder. What life? You know, there are so many names for our God. One of the names is El Olam, which means our God is everlasting God. How many of you know that? He is the Alpha. He is the Omega. He is the beginning. He is the end. He is for everlasting. So, if you believed in this God, this is the life that he has given. He has given you eternal life. Eternal life means what? According to the Greek word, it means so simple. Without end. Never to cease. The life that God has given you is for everlasting. How many of you believe that? You and I, we are not called to live a life in this world where we will live and we die and it's over. No. It's more than that. Are you listening? The life that we live in this world, it's not about just eating, drinking, working, you know, putting the children in the school, and then there'll come a day, everybody, we need to die. When we die, it's over. No. Even after death, that's what is important. The life that which we are going to live with him is forever. And if you have to understand this, please listen. 1 John 5:13 says, if you read, you'll understand. This everlasting life, every child of God who understands that he is being blessed with eternal life, everlasting life. You know what gives to that person? Confidence in life. Come on, say what? Confidence. In spite of failures, we will be confident. In spite of mistakes, we'll be confident. In spite of loss, we'll be confident. In spite of not seeing the dream being fulfilled, there will be a confidence in you and me, because our life is what life? Everlasting life. It's eternal life. It's not going to get over just on this earth. If you want to understand this, you need to read Psalm 39 from verse 1 to 7. I would like to read it for you. The psalmist, he says, I said, I will guard my ways that I may not sin with my tongue. I will guard my mouth with the muzzle. So long as the wicked are in my presence, I was mute and silent. I held my peace to no avail, and my distress grew worse. My heart became hot within me. As I mused, the fire burned. Then I spoke with my tongue, O Lord, make me know my end, and what is the measure of my days? Let me know how fleeting I am. Behold, you have made my days a few handbreadths, and my lifetime is nothing before you. Surely all mankind stands as a mere breath. Surely a man goes about as a shadow. Surely for nothing they are in turmoil. Man heaps up wealth and does not know who will gather. And now, O Lord, what do I wait? He did not stop there. Then he says, my hope is in you. Until this moment, these words should be and will be the words of people who are outside, not a child of God like you and me. Amen. But for you, we are not worried about, you know, how long, how, when, what. We are not going to be worried about all those things, because our hope is not just in this life that we live. Our hope is eternal life. How many of you believe with me? Amen. To understand this better, I would like to read from 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18. Most of the time we read these words, you know, either in a funeral home or we go to a house where somebody is dead, the body is there. I've done that. But I believe that we need to read this clearly, slowly, now, to believe that our life is for eternity. From verse 13 to 18, 1 Thessalonians 4:13 to 18. Please listen. But we do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about those who are asleep, that you may not grieve as others who have no hope. For since we believe that Jesus died and rose again, even so through Jesus, God will bring with him those who have fallen asleep. So those who have fallen asleep, those people who have received Jesus, who have fallen asleep, when Jesus comes, so what we understand is Jesus is coming again. Can I hear an amen? When, how, nobody knows, but we know for sure he is coming again. A believer constantly should remind, you know, to himself or herself that Jesus is returning any moment. How many of you agree with me? Amen? He is coming back, you know, he is coming again at any moment. Nobody knows. How do you know it's very near? Because of the signs that's been mentioned in the word. Because of the signs, and these signs that we see now, that we are getting closer. It says, he is coming again, the dead will rise again. For this we declare to you by word from the Lord, that we who are alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the voice of an archangel, and with the sound of the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive, who are left, will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will always be with the Lord. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Not standing before a dead body, we need to read this and encourage one another. As a child of God, as a believer, we go through challenges. Amavalia. We go through pain. You know, we go through suffering. We go through sicknesses. Right? When we go through, when you see another brother, another sister go through, you are there to stand and encourage, telling Jesus is coming again. Amen? And we are going to meet him. And we are going to live with him for ever. So the life that a Christian lives should be like this. Not looking, you know, not just looking in this way, looking in this way. Encourage one another. He is going to come again. It means there is going to be something called a life after death. So having this understanding, please listen. If you believed in Jesus' death and resurrection and his coming, you are saved. So you are in that life's journey, waiting to meet the Lord. In that journey, as you live in this challenging world, when we live with this perspective and understanding, your life will be and should be different. There should be a difference between the way that you choose things, that you set your priority to the one who has not found the Lord. You and I, we should not be running the same life, thinking the same way, getting up in the same way, going to work in the same way, coming back in the same way. No. We, the redeemed, should live a life with a view of eternity. Can I repeat it? With a view of eternity. When you do that, it will affect your life drastically. Amen? It will affect your life. It's for good. You can avoid a certain kind of stress. You can avoid a certain pain. You can avoid certain disappointment. Because not every disappointment is because somebody has done against us. Certain things are because we have done certain things against us. We have done. Nammala poi thalai uttom adha. We, because everybody is doing, I want to do it. Everybody is running this race, I want to run. Everybody is buying, I want to buy. Everybody is going to that college, I want to go. With eternity in your mind, if you and I will live, life will be joyful on this earth. Can I hear an amen? Challenges will be there, stress will be there. But most of the unwanted stuff, we can avoid. How many of you agree with me? Because we will think different. We will choose differently. Our priority will be different. We will not look the same way how the world looks. Amen? If we have eternity in our mind, we'll be waiting for His coming. And His coming will be at any time. Amen? So we'll be waiting. When we wait, this is how life should be. In 1 Peter 4, 7 to 11, quickly I want to place before you three simple, you know, things that we need to remember. We do that. Three simple things that we need to place before us. If you read 1 Peter 4, 7 to 11, Peter, he writes these words to the church, to the believers. The believers who are going through every kind of challenge. And now he's talking to them and he's telling them, but the end of all things is at hand. How many of you believe that? The end of all things is at hand. Therefore, the first thing he's telling, be serious and watchful in your prayers. Be serious and watchful in your prayers. More than ever before, we've been constantly looking out the creation, then the new creation. Before the new creation, how the fall came. You know why the fall came? It's because of man's disobedience. And before that, we saw the beauty of God's creation. You are the crown of all God's creation. Who didn't like it? The enemy didn't like it. Not only then, now you have been redeemed through the blood of Jesus. Can I hear an amen? You have been bought with the blood of Jesus. You are a child of God. You are His son, His daughter, His inheritance. Again, I tell you, who doesn't like it? You know who doesn't like it? The devil doesn't like it. The enemy does not like it. You are in war. Always you are standing in the front line. Please listen. Your salvation is precious. Is it? Yes or no? Your salvation is precious. The life that God has ordained for you, you know, in this earth is so important. Not just for you, for His kingdom. Can I hear an amen? Yes. You are special. You are so important. That's why the enemy doesn't like it. That's why the first thing here, Peter teaches these people. He's telling them, be serious and watchful in prayer. Prayer. Why we need to pray? It's because my father and mother tells me, good, do that. That'll become a habit to you. Amen. Why we need to pray? These words, from verse 11 onwards, it talks about relationship with God and relationship with people. Be serious. Not a casual prayer life. if we take last week, how's our prayer life? You think about your prayer life. If you believe that it is so important for your walk with the Lord, if you believe that this is so important for your relationship with God, if you believe that this is so important for the plan and purpose that God has for your life, you will take it seriously. Can I hear an amen? That is one part of it. The second part of it is a little dangerous. If you believe that you can handle, if you believe that you can manage, if you believe because of pride, that's what the Bible says, because of pride that I can handle, I can manage, I don't need God in my life. So first thing when I get up, I'll rush out to do my job, my project, my family, my thing. But before that, if I acknowledge without God, it's not possible, I will take this seriously. Can I hear an amen? Yes. But it's not because of this, but because of the other part, walking in relationship with Him. Why we need that more than ever before? Because we believe prayer is not about just sitting in a corner for 15 minutes or even 15 hours, closing eyes and praying. Yes, that's prayer. But even while walking, even while traveling, amen? Even while doing my job, I can be in constant connection with my God. Because the Spirit of God is where? In you, inside. We need that constant connection because every 5 minutes, every hour, we need to make decisions in our life, whether to see that or not, whether to talk like that or not, whether to go or not, whether to choose or not. Amen. Not only for your personal life, for your business, I'm telling, for your job, I'm telling, for the family, with regard to children, every moment, right? Every day we are making decisions. Please listen. If it does not come from inside, it's coming from here or coming from outside, it's a worldly decision. It's not a godly decision. The devil will push you and me to do that. So many people will come and talk. Sometimes brothers will come, brother, sister. You know? Yes, it's okay to listen to those things, but when I have this privilege to have the direct call. You know, those days when you have to call to US, what they call it? Connect call or what call? You know, you need to go tell the fellow in the booth, you know, and then after 15 minutes or half an hour, you will be connected. Right? Collect call, adu vera. Ingendu pesi avana selavu vechiralam. That call is there, right? Those days. But no. Now you want to get connected directly? Yes. Why you need to look into people? You and I, we needed that every hour, every minute. You know why? Because the devil is waiting like a roaring lion to finish you. We have come to a place, how many of you agree with me? We have come to a place where we cannot make just simple mistake only. No. Maybe for me, for my age, I'm telling. I've come across for 30 years walking with the Lord. Now I cannot say, no, Lord, it's okay. A small mistake, then it's okay. I can get back to the track again. No. Certain things, no. Certain decisions in your family, you cannot. You need to be constantly in connection with the Lord. So take seriously. Come on, say seriously and watchfully. You need to pray. Pray. You and I, we cannot say there is no time, Pastor. The devil will take all our time then. There is no time. We will have all the time in the world to sit and watch what? Whatever you add it. You know, a football match in the middle of the night, World Cup, you know, at any point of time. These are some good stuff. Slowly I'll build it, okay? World Cup, you know, then at least some movies, good movies, little bit, you know. Then we'll go on, right? After serial, we'll have you know, all the time in the world. But I want to tell you, church, you are so important for the kingdom of God. Be serious in your prayer. Be serious in your relationship with God. Be watchful in your relationship with God. Amen. This is so important. The second thing here, he talks about, what is that? And above all things, have fervent love for one. No, casual love. Casual love is very dangerous. Okay, right. Fervent love for one another. Why is so important? According to 2 Timothy chapter 3, Paul is teaching whom? Timothy. And telling him, Timothy, in the last days, everything will be abundance. There's one thing that will not be there. You know what is that? Love. Tamil nalla alaga irukum. Anbu tanindu pogum. You know, this morning, today morning, I watched watched a clipping in Facebook. You know what I saw? It was shocking. Please listen. All that I saw is an old man standing outside a house. I don't know whether it's wife or daughter standing, few people. A crazy fellow from inside. Later I found from that video that is his own son. From inside the house, throwing all the old man's things outside. Even the sofa, the chair, clothes. He's throwing it on the street. Some problem with the father with regard to property. Look at the level people are going. Sad. Why talk about outside? Here Peter is talking about people in the church, in the Christian home. You know, in the Christian home, in the church. He's telling, you know, no casual love, no shallow love. He's telling fervent love for one another. Love each other. Because he says, then love covers multitude of sin. The real person can be seen only when the person is challenged. Amen? I'm not talking people outside. Us. We are fine, we come together as a church, worship, pray, smile. You know, when you go for a retreat, camp. But when there is some kind of challenge, that's when the reality creeps in. And sometimes it is shocking. Shocking. Why talk about people outside? I'm not judging anybody. I'm including myself also with all of you. It's shocking the way that we speak, that the way that we react, that the way that we jump into conclusion, that the way that we respond to people, to brothers and sisters who are brought together with the same blood, the blood of Jesus, to live together as a family. He's telling, hey, last days, love one another. Love earnestly. Because in the last days, you know, there is abundance of food. Can I hear an amen? Everywhere that you turn, restaurants. Abundance, food, school. School, college, right? Job, company, people, right? Even garment shops. Those days only madrasa. How many of you from my generation? Utta, enga oduva, pushavakam. Only madrasa. Deencha koi nalla irukadhu nenikiren, solradhinga. Only mother shop we go by. But now, you know, every place is welcoming, inviting. 20% off welcoming us. You know, then we go closer and we found out, we'll find this. You know what? Doorthu paakumbodhu 50%. Pakkathu poi paathadha up to 50%. Nammal arachiruvom malaga. Sila baking appadiye pogum. Ayyo, 50% off. Up to 50% potirpa. Why go to shop? Online. Online you can order. In the picture, what you see will be different. What you get will be different. Amen. You know? online, everything, but Bible very clearly says, right? How many of you agree with me? Anbu, there'll be lack of love. How many of you agree with me? Lack of love. We've seen that so much, everything increased. Lack of love. 15 years back, this thing started in our nation. This curse came in, you know. Sorry, IT people, sorry, corporate people, sorry. This thing came inside 15 years back or 20 years back to our nation. I don't know. At least 15 years, things changed, right? I already told you, which took people like my father, you know, it took almost, 30 years of working or 35 years of working, then thinking about buying a land. Guys, at the age of 28, nothing wrong about it. Getting a house or 25, getting a house and car and everything. It was all about, you know, earning money. It's all about earning money. It's all about working and earning money and buying. Not only husband, wife, you also go work. Then only we can build. You know, there was abundance, right? Money was abundance. Business was abundance. Everything was abundance. But the result of it, you and I, we see now. All these things went up. Health came down. Peace at home came down. And what increased is divorce rate increased, right? That cycle has gone and it's come back. By the time it has come back to reality, but already it has destroyed two generations. For that to recover, I believe it will take another next four generations. It has affected the next four generations, I believe. Lack of love. But church, can we live like Jesus? Amen. Yes, we need the Father's love. You might say, Pastor, it's easy to preach, Pastor. How about that person? I know that person. That is the person. Yeah, Munnadi, she's talking, you know, like, you know, she loves me, he loves me, but behind. But I'm called to love my enemy. In human strength, it is not possible. But I tell you, that's what the Bible says. We need to ask the Father, fill my heart, Lord, with your love. The Holy Spirit is not just to speak in tongues. The Holy Spirit is not just for gifts of the Spirit. Bible says the Holy Spirit will pour out the Father's love into your heart. We need to pray every day, Lord, fill my heart with your love, Lord. Amen. To love my enemy. To love people who speak against me. To love people who does not like me. Bible says, love each other. I don't want to read 1 John chapter 3. I believe it's in chapter 3 from verse 10 to 18. It is very hard. Even harder than what I shared now. You go home and read. He's telling you, it's very clearly, it tells, if you do not love, you are like a person who's not saved. If you say that you are redeemed, if you are not able to love one another, you are compared to a person who is evil. That's the word it's written, evil. We'll read that, okay? 1 John. I think it's in chapter 10, chapter 3, verse 10. By this it is made clear who take their nature from God and are his children, and who take their nature from the devil. 1 John 3, 10. By this it is made clear to who take the nature from God and are his children, and who take the nature from the devil and are his children. No one who does not practice righteousness, who does not conform to God's will in purpose, thought, and action, is of God. Neither is anyone who does not love his brother, fellow believer in Christ. In Amplified Bible, it is there. If I'm not able to love my fellow believer in Christ, I do not belong to God. I belong to devil. Wow. I think this is a little serious, right? The world needs love. How many of you agree with me? More than any other person, it's only you and I we can show that love, because we have the Father's unconditional love in us. Amen. And finally, the third thing is telling, be hospitable to one another without grumbling. He's telling, share, help people. So simple, eh? He's telling, you are living for eternity, huh? And this is how your life should be. Be connected with God, watchful in prayer, serious in prayer. Then be connected with people. Focus on that. Focus on that. And one more thing is added to that is help one another. And I thank God for our church. Yeah, we've been seeing this constantly. There is one problem in this. Help one another, do charity. Right? It's not a problem here in this congregation. In some congregation, that will be a problem. You can take it as a Tamil congregation. When you tell that we need to help people, you know, in charity, in you know, in the need, in the financial need, whatever it is, that can sometimes that can become a trap for them to become lazy. But at the same time, we need to help people. We need to help. Because in Thessalonian church, the church of Thessalonica, they had this problem. Paul did this, the pastor did this, they collected, they helped people who were suffering. But there, later they found out there were some people, they abused this help. They were not doing anything. They were idle. They were idle. They did not do their job. They could have gone out and worked. They lost the job. You go and find. The reason will be they would not have gone in time. They would not have done the job properly. Because of that, they would have lost the job. They did not do it well. They used this and they started to, you know, abuse this help. That should not happen. God is not telling be idle. Get the help from other brother and sister. No. If you find somebody who cannot do that, if you find somebody who's suffering, help. Share whatever you can. Are you listening? What God is telling here, church, if you read the later part of the same verse in 1 Peter 4, everybody has a gift. How many of you agree with me? Everybody has a gift. And he says, if you have the gift to speak, use that. If you have gift to help, help. If you have to gift, you know, to create an opportunity for somebody, do that. And then he says, do it for the glory of God. Can I hear an amen? Not for my name. My name should be there, brother. My name should be there, sister. You know, just tell people that I did it. No. Very clearly it's there. Do it with a humble heart, for God's name will be glorified. And then he says, you know, when you do that, you will do that, it will help others. So together we will live and we will wait upon the Lord for his return, because that life is more important than the life that we are living now. How many of you agree with me? This is the life cycle of a believer. This is the life cycle of a believer. We keep the eternity before and we live our life. We are called for eternal life. Can I hear an amen?